Has this really interesting alchemy going on of both a strong emphasis on justice, a strong emphasis on God's fairness for all, but also one that is done with joy and gratitude.
In many ways, it's about what I call building beloved community. And it has always seemed to me that Union Church is a place that is about building beloved community.
Boundless love, hospitality, kindness, peace, justice, all of the things that we want for our world, this church stands for.
Paul says instead, do what you do for you. Keep it straight.
Since coming here, I realized that there is a community that will love you, whether you believe one thing or another. It's that we're worshiping together as a community, that we're giving of ourselves, whether it be as Sunday school teachers or as musicians, sharing our talents or tithing what you can or tithing in other ways, you know, in non-monetary ways.
I give of my time, money, and my spirit, part of the community. I enjoy being part of a faith community.
I give in ways that I can as a student, which is through my creativity.
I sing in the choir. Tom helps with the Sunday school class. We kind of look at it as a give back, because we have received so much.
Union Church works in many areas. We work locally, we work state and nationally, and we work internationally. So some of the folks that we give to are developing communities in El Salvador. We give to Bread for the World. We also give locally. We work with things like our Women's Creative Sewing and Crafts program.
Union Church folks, and probably people in general, are very, very concerned about what goes on in the world and have many things that they could give their money to. You shouldn't give money to anything that doesn't really matter to you. I think you should support Union Church if you care about a future where there might be more peace and more justice. If you want to see that world built, supporting Union Church is a great way to start. And Union Church then can support the next generation and the next generation and the next generation of leaders who will, I hope, bring us closer to that goal.
We want to make sure that the doors are open and all people feel welcome. And anybody is welcome here. And a member is someone who decides I'm going to be the one to help make sure those doors are open.
It's easy to stay within budget. All we have to do is not do the things that make us a great church. We could cut children's programming, and we could cut music out. We could stop all of that. We spend a lot of money on those things, but we do that because they matter. They really matter. If we stop that just to balance a budget, we're not being the church God calls us to be.
Membership means commitment.
Everyone has a part to play.
Planning means thinking ahead.
Make a pledge. Be our future.
Support the church.
And the social justice issues that matter to all of us.
We're serving and loving together.
We're serving and loving together.
We are serving and loving together.
We're serving and loving together.
Union Church is serving and loving together. Will you join us?
Yeah.
Good morning, all. Good morning. Can you hear me out? We're checking out our mics here.
Good morning.
Check, check. I can hear Rachel.
Well, that's good.
Okay.
Oh, good. There's it. There.
Very good.
Welcome, all. We're so glad that you're here this morning at Union Church. Ooh, that's very loud. We have a new computer up in the sound booth, so this is its debut performance, so forgive us as we make minor adjustments as we go through. We're delighted to welcome all of you this morning to Union Church. Thank you for coming out on a gray and cold day. It's better to be together and be warm with each other's spirits, so thank you. We wanted to especially welcome those of you who might be visitors or guests joining us for the first time. We're delighted to welcome you as a church family and to make you at home. So if there's things that would help with that, we sure would like to know what they are. And if you would need a large print bulletin or a hearing assistance device, please let us know or poke somebody next to you. They're available in the narthex. There's also a restroom back there should that become needed during the service, and you'd be very welcome to take advantage of all of those things.
If you are someone or with someone who needs room to wiggle or a place to be slightly louder or a place to have coloring materials or things to help keep you focused throughout the service, we do have a children and those who partake. Worship center in the back there with crayons and papers and books and toys and things to help us worship together all as one.
Indeed. You'll find a red pew folder on the edge of your pew somewhere. It looks a little bit like this right here. Oh, looks like that. And if you wouldn't mind to fill that out and pass that down, that'll help everybody know who's here, and we'd love to welcome you all officially. If you give us your contact information, we'll make sure to reach out to you if that is your desire. So just check the appropriate boxes and we'll make sure to reach out if you'd like.
We have a few announcements today. Many of them are in your bulletin. There's lots of reading to do during the boring parts of the sermon. I get to say that because I'm preaching today. So, please, this is how we get our information to you. This and the weekly email and our newsletter, these are the ways that you get to stay informed. So it is up to you to read them or ask somebody if you need help with that. So, one thing that we do want to note, though, is that Patty Smithson has worked very, very hard and created the annual statements of your giving over the past year. You will need these for your taxes. So they are over here. She will be meeting people by the peace bell to help you find them after the service. And then you can just go on, and we have coffee and snacks available after that. So go right through the door and celebrate together. If you have an item that you want to put in the bulletin, please let Joan know. Her contact information is on the back here. You can call, email, use carrier pigeon, whatever. We'll get the information to the office by Friday morning.
Exactly. One of the things we're doing today is we're going to be singing a hymn that you'll find on page 3 of your bulletin, and I thought you might like to hear it so that the Lord's people can be prepared to do the Lord's work, that is the work of the people, the singing today. This is a round, and so what we'll do is this morning, I'll just sing it for you, and you can sing along with me just to sing it through once, and then when we come to the place in the service where we sing it, which will be our opening hymn, I'll invite you to sing as a round, and here's how we'll do that. We've got lovely assistants over here, and each section we'll take a section and sing it through. But here's how the whole round goes. Gabe? Here's how it sounds.
What does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord require of you?
To sing it through when we do it in the service itself. So now you're all prepared. You sounded great. You sound good.
Yes, beautiful. We have several folks to hold in our prayers. We particularly want to continue to offer up traveling mercies, especially to those going through our international airports. Many who are coming to or from countries that it's now much more difficult to come to or from, and sometimes impossible, particularly those who are now banned and trying to return to family, school, or the place that they call home. We'll continue to pray for Deborah Payne, that she makes her way back from Uganda safely as well. We have a list of folks on page 7 that we want to hold in the prayers. One to note is that Loretta Mountjoy, who's been in the hospital for a couple of weeks, is now home, which is good news, but she could still use your prayers. She's still in major recovery mode.
Indeed.
We also want to pray for all of those who are suffering through war and tragedy. And today we also want to light our justice candle. We do this every week to remind us of the places where the light of Christ's justice pops up in the middle of the darkness. And late last night, a new light popped up. We want to honor the ACLU lawyers who acted quickly to... to keep those who were about to be deported back to war zones from being taken back. It's only the beginning, but they were released. Some of them were released from the airport. Some are still detained, but a federal judge did grant the stay so that they were not immediately deported. So we give thanks for their quick and firm, just actions.
Indeed. My friends, these are troublous times, as it says on the plaque that was the cornerstone of this church. It says, John G. Fee and the others founded this church in troublous times. So it is good in troublous times to gather together. It will take our hearts, our minds, our bodies, and our souls to love that which makes all truly free. So I hope and pray that you will join us as we gather our strength in this hour, as we gather our prayers in this hour, and as we gather our motivation and plan our actions in this hour. It is God's strength upon which we rely. It is God's hope for which we work. Let us be about that work as we worship together in this place. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I invite those who are able to stand and join in the call to worship. What does the Lord require of you?
To do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with our God.
What does God command of us?
To love God with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind and all our strength and to love our neighbor as ourselves.
God does not call us to ease or to comfort,
but to presence and abundance and grace in our struggle.
Let us worship the God who believes in us and trusts in us and abides in us.
Let us worship the God who will ask much of us, but will be beside us every step of the way.
Would you join in our prayer of approach and confession? If you'd like, you may remain standing, or if you are tired, you may be seated. We have heard it said, look after number one.
Get them before they get you.
Better safe than sorry.
What someone else's problems got to do with me?
Only the strong survive.
Money makes the world go round.
And revenge is sweet.
Avoid pain at all costs.
May God forgive us when, as Christ's own people, we believe these words to be life-giving, when Jesus has shown us a better way. Let us pray. Lord, hear our prayer. Amen. When we feel soiled by our own selfishness, we are brought close by Jesus, who gathers us still, who turns to listen to our voices, who reaches out to touch us with hands. He is not afraid to get dirty, to embrace us, who, in moments of accepting us for who we are, shows us that we are forgiven, and worthy of love and respect. My friends, thanks be to God. Amen. Won't you turn to your neighbors right and left and offer them a sign of love, respect, peace, and grace this morning. Peace be all to all.
Now let us settle into the peace of beautiful music.
Our Hebrew scripture lesson this morning comes from the prophet Micah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, and you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God?
Now, I would invite our youngest prophets among us, the young and young at heart, to come forward and let's talk a little bit about this famous passage.
Good morning, everybody. How are you? Oh, we got more coming. Yay. Come on up. We got stools if you want them, or you can be right there on the floor. How you doing? Good.
Yeah. That was a good like this.
Yeah, that was. It's supposed to be a snow day. And so, what direction are your prayers headed? Snowward. They are headed snowward. Absolutely. Oh, I love a good snow day. Oh, there's nothing better. That's wonderful. Absolutely.
I have a question for you. And there's no right answer to this. So don't feel pressure.
42.
Okay, there's a wrong answer. Why do we come to church? This is a hard one for those guys too, just so you don't feel bad.
Yeah. Got any ideas? Why do people come to church? Why do you come to church? Yeah.
To see my friend
Berea.
To see your friends, yeah. That's a really important thing about church. It's a place where we can connect with people that we love and care about.
Yeah. What else? Why else do you
Anybody
come?
Else?
Or why do you think people come?
Yeah, maybe why have your parents told you we are going to church because? Anybody? Nobody's going to admit it. What'd you say? Well, one of the things I think we come to church for is what was in our Bible today. And it's to learn how to do three very important things. We don't come so that we give the right offering, and we don't come so that we say the right prayers or that we sing the right songs. We come to learn and to help each other learn how to do three very important things. So we're going to talk to you about those, okay? Number one, do justice. Now that is a tough word. Anybody have any idea of what justice means? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of hard to explain.
Right.
It is kind of hard to explain,
like,
but it has something
rights.
To do with rights.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Maybe also another word sometimes is fairness, mm-hmm. right? Making sure that everyone is treated fairly and within their rights. Yeah. Right?
How are ways that you help fairness happen? Has anybody ever helped to make sure that fairness happens? It's a hard thing to do sometimes, right? Sometimes if somebody's not sharing, it might mean standing up to that person and saying, hey, it's this person's turn to play. Or if you're the one not sharing, it might mean saying, okay, it's your turn to play.
And if you have 5 cupcakes and there's 3 more people in the room and they don't have any cupcakes,
laugh
at them. No. No, we have to sort of adjust, right? I mean, doing justice means sort of looking after ourselves first, right? Making sure that we are taking account of the people we love and care about, that you came to church to be with, right? To people to play with. So it's important. But not just people at church, right? We come to church to remind ourselves that justice and fairness and equality and all those things are for everybody. If God said to do it, God said it to all the people, not just some of the people, right? So that's one of the things. Yeah.
Speaking of cupcakes, after the Navy rushed out of cupcakes, we had to go to special items because I wanted more cupcakes.
Mm. Oh, well, there you go. So maybe you're off cupcakes.
You're willing to share your cupcakes.
There you go.
Yeah, okay, that's great.
What's the second thing?
Number two, love kindness.
Mm.
Now, this is a word that might be a little bit easier, but what are things you think of with kindness? That's number two. You got it. What's an example of being kind? Giving cupcakes.
Giving cupcakes is a kindness.
Not just sharing, but making them and giving them. Yeah. Maybe giving them even to people that you don't like.
Mm.
Yeah. We're making people hungry. Okay, we're not going to use cupcakes. Yeah. Donating money.
Right.
Yes, exactly.
Right.
Maybe even simple things, giving a hug, sitting with someone who's crying. Yeah.
Ordering pizza.
Ordering pizza, if you're willing to share it, yes.
Right, exactly.
Poor Matthew is getting really hungry, okay.
That's right.
All right, so that was one, do justice. Two, love kindness. And three, and I'm gonna ask for Reverend Kent's help with this. Do you know what it is?
What is it? Not yet.
All right. Number three is walk humbly with your God. And Reverend Kent, will you demonstrate walking humbly?
Yes, this is my humble walk.
Okay. I think that's a slight misunderstanding.
Right, my humorous walk.
Yes, not humorous walk.
Oh.
Humble walk.
Oh, so this is not the ministry of silly walks?
This is not the ministry of silly walks.
Dang it. Okay, so the humble thing.
The humble thing, yes. What does it mean to be humble?
I have no idea.
You are not alone. An easy way to think about being humble is to remember that you might be right sometimes, but you might not be right sometimes. And that there's always a chance to learn from other people. So that even people that we think are completely wrong about everything are probably right about something. And that if we let God teach us, and if we let God help us listen, sometimes you have to pray really hard to help listen, because sometimes it's really hard to listen. But if we let God help us be humble, then we can continue to learn and grow from other people.
You know, the word humble means to be kind of low to the ground, right? Low to the ground. It doesn't mean that you're like, you know, don't ever take credit for what you've worked hard for. That's not what humble is. Humble means you are close to reality. You are right there with what you know yourself to be and what you know God has made you to be. Humble is about being lined up right with the way God sees the world, right? So we're not in charge of things entirely, but we're also not powerless.
Yep.
We're in the middle. And being humble means knowing that and always wondering, are we in the right place? Are we working hard to help others be in the right place? That's part of humility that's really important. It matters that we use the strength and gifts that God gave you. Right? It matters that you use those and that you sing if you sing, that you write if you write, that you do math if you do math, that you use those gifts. It's not humble to squelch your light.
Mm-hmm.
But it is humble to say, hey, there are other people who do this too. I'm trying to do the best I can, and there's other people trying to do the best they can, and we could do it together. That's another kind of humility.
So you do know what humble means.
See? I pay attention to children's moments.
Oh, good.
I've learned so much.
All right, do you think we can remember them? If you remember these three things, you will do really well. If you remember them and try to do them.
Mm.
Okay, so number one, do...
Justice.
Do justice.
Right.
Number two, love. Kindness.
Kindness.
Three, walk
humbly
with God. Let's try it one
humbly.
More time. One, do justice. Two,
love kindness.
Three,
walk humbly with God. Exactly.
All right, you got it?
Thanks, you guys.
Okay. What can we pray for today as we humbly ask God for things that we need or know other people need? Any prayers? Yeah.
My grandpa's going on a trip.
Your grandpa's going on a trip, so we want to make sure that he has safe travel.
Yes. Mercies.
Yeah.
All right.
Kittens.
All right.
Yes, we need lots of kittens in this world.
Amen.
But we also need them to be
loved.
Loved, yes.
People always used to say this.
pizza.
Yes, pizza. And we, sorry, Matthew. Yes, we will pray that you will find pizza or cupcakes or some kind of delicious food sometime soon. Okay.
Well, shall we pray together? Would you join us? There's lots of ways to pray. And so if you want to keep your eyes open, you can. If you want to close your eyes, you can. If you want to cross your arms, you can. However it is you find prayer, let's find a good spot.
Okay. God, we thank you for teaching us to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with you. Help us do those things, God, because sometimes that's hard. We pray for people traveling, especially Cadence's grandfather, and kittens and all those creatures of your creation that give us joy. And we pray that all will have the food that they need and sometimes even the delicious food that they want. Walk with us, God, and help us to do your will. Together we say,
Amen. Thanks, you guys. Thanks for coming up.
A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak, and he taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the word of God for today. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, through the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts, we ask humbly your blessing. Amen. So, I can't tell you how many times I rewrote this sermon this week. This has been a choppy sea, shall we say, of a week. I have gone from the time of the inauguration with fears about what it will be like to seeing hints of how very bad it might be. It's felt like emotional whiplash, and I have contributed to that by spending too much time on Facebook and letting myself get torn hither and yon with anxiety. Just a few things that happened this week. People were nominated to cabinet positions when they want to destroy the department that they were nominated to. And yet also, courts found Alabama's gerrymandering unconstitutional. Journalists were arrested and charged with felonies for covering protests. But also, other journalists stood up and got much clearer about what is a lie and what is an alternative fact. We were told lies about crowd sizes, and agencies were shut down and told to silence their voices. And Twitter responded with rogue accounts and people who said, "You can't tell me what to do on my free time." A climate conference was canceled, and Al Gore and his agencies decided, "Oh no, it's on, we're gonna foot the bill." Mosques were burned, Muslims banned from entering the United States,
and masses of people rose up and went to airports and got lawyers and got a judge's restraining order. These are, as Reverend Kent said, quoting John Fee, troublous times. I have had the benefit of always being at least two steps away from oppressive regimes. I have had the benefit in my 37 years of getting to feel bad for people who were struggling, of getting to witness and support people who were homeless, of getting to read accounts of people who suffered in the Holocaust, of getting to admire the people in the civil rights movement. I had lots of empathy for these folks. I suffered nightmares for most of my childhood, imagining the Gestapo coming to my door. But I could always wake up. I always knew I was safe. So this week is about the closest I've come to what a lot of those people who've gone before us have felt. And I've been freaking out. I don't know about y'all, but I have been freaking out. I have been asking, how do I protect my kid while also being a good and faithful Christian? How do I ingest the mountain of news that is necessary to keep up while also maintaining my mental health? How do I live in this new world, this new society? I got a helpful phone call this week from my mama. And I was reminded to listen to my elders, and the first thing she said was, turn off Facebook. You have posted too much today. Thanks, Mom. And while I was mad at her, because I felt very self-righteous about my posts, she was right. I needed to take a step back. I needed to withdraw for a moment and to think on my own, not with other people's influences, not with all of those voices of anger and anxiety. And when I thought, I was reminded, listen to your elders. Listen to your elders who have been here before. Listen to people like my mother, people like those who have been through the civil rights movement, people who have written like Bonhoeffer and sacrificed themselves, people who are still going through all of this, like the Reverend William Barber, who led Moral Mondays in North Carolina and is now becoming one of our great leaders in these troublous times. People like John Lewis, and people further back, people like John Fee, people like the prophets in the Bible. Our Bible is filled with hope for troublous times. Our Bible was written for people and by people in troublous times. Our Bible is full of strength. And so often, we have been afraid to turn it open because we have been afraid of ways it has been used to clobber and oppress, ways it has been used to destroy. That fear is one of the reasons I never much liked the Beatitudes. I felt like they were just ways for the oppressor to say, oh, be calm in your poorness, be calm in your sorrow. You're going to get a reward later. But if we look again, and I will tell you that Sally Zimmerman is the one who helped me look again in Bible study on Thursday. And she reminded me of the ways that her mother and her stepfather, Carl Eschbach, and all of the missionaries that they were with who were imprisoned in the Japanese camps in the Philippines during World War II relied on the Bible, relied on the blessings of the Beatitudes to get them through those tough times. Amen. Do you know that a lot of the translations, not the ones that most of us have usually read, but a lot of the translations of the Beatitudes say, happy are the poor in spirit. Happy are those who mourn. So that really ticked me off. Don't you tell me how to feel. Don't you tell me to cheer up when I feel sad? But Sally and some other folks that I have read during my little one-day Sabbath from Facebook helped me see that that happy was a deeper resistance. That happiness in the face of oppression is the biggest insult you can give. Amen. That joy, despite pain, finding a place of love in the middle of hate, is in fact the most powerful force in the world. Happy, blessed, is an alternative hope. It's a chance to tell the death-dealing culture of oppression, you can't get me, no matter what. And the Bible is our source of how to go there. Micah reminds us that it doesn't matter what all of the righteousness says. If you are not busy doing God's work of justice and kindness and humility, if you are not focused on those things and on Jesus' commandment to love God and love your neighbor, it doesn't matter how many times you show up to choir practice. Sorry, Gabe. It doesn't matter whether you have perfect attendance at church. But if we let those things support us in our journey of hope, if we let the joy of singing, even singing badly, lift our spirits in the middle of deadening toxicity, we will make it. We will make it through. And so the Beatitudes were opened up for me in a new way. These are, in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus' first public act of teaching. They are, if you will, his inauguration speech. And they are so powerful in that a very subversive evangelical pastor even read them at Donald Trump's inauguration. And there's a new way I learned to look at them that I want to share with you this week. There's a way to say they are not just, oh, blessed are the poor, blessed are the meek, blessed are all those people. Yes, they're blessed, bless their hearts. I got this idea from Nadia Boltz-Weber, an amazing Lutheran pastor. Shout out to the Lutherans up there. Who probably helped get it from other places too. But she had this idea that what if the blessings aren't just prescriptive? What if they aren't just saying, oh yes, these people are blessed and these people are blessed and these people are blessed? What if they are in fact what she called performative? What if in the act of saying, blessed are those, you are bringing that blessing upon them? What if in the act of saying, blessed are those who have no hope, for they will find hope, you are bringing that possibility of hope into the world? What if they are saying, despite what the world says about money being the ultimate power, they are saying, no, blessed are those who see beyond that. Blessed are those who know that eternal life is now and accessible. And through the words of Jesus, and through the communions of the saints, and through the acts of doing justice and loving kindness and walking humbly, we have access to those blessings. And we may not always feel them as happy-go-lucky, but we might feel them as a deep hope, a deep joy, a lack of giving up for just one more day. This happiness is what has kept our ancestors in faith alive for so long. And it comes out in funny ways. I was talking to someone who was telling me about the base communities in El Salvador when they were facing serious oppression. And there were groups that were fighting all over the place. There were Marxist groups who were fighting for socialism, and there were base communities who were fighting out of a deep Christian conviction. And somebody asked the cardinal, Carlo Paolo Arns, Why is it that the base communities are so much more popular? And he said, because we have more fun. They are busy being dour and hopeless and sounding alarms. And we are busy saying, there is joy in the gospel. There is joy in equality. There is joy in justice. There's a reason we fight for it, because it's better. And we believe that. And we party when we see that possibility. It's the possibility that allowed Julian of Norwich, when one third of the European world around her was dying of the plague, to proclaim that all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. It's a miraculous joy and hope. It's the hope of a civil rights protester in Birmingham that Joan Baez quotes in a song that I heard her say one time, where she said, right before they went out to protest in the streets, she said, we have to go with joy. We have to go singing. We have to go so that the people will see us and they will know our joy, and they'll simply just come and join us because they'll know it's the best place to be. It's the joy of the people who know that the kingdom of God is all around us, and it is fun. It is the joy of the people who had a queer dance party in front of Mike Pence's house this week. I particularly love that one. It is the joy of redemption, the joy of saying, we matter, you are blessed. This strength that comes from Scripture is particularly powerful in the Beatitudes. And I would like to read to you a version of the Beatitudes for our modern times that was created in combination with Nadia Boltz-Weber and a colleague of mine, Ashley Harness, and me, that we put together. Nadia doesn't know that we did this. She'll approve, though, I hope. But before I do that, I want to remind you that this power of the Bible is available and accessible to you every Sunday morning in Bible study at 9:30. Every Thursday afternoon at noon, noodling around with theology on Thursday evening at 8. You don't have to do this alone, people. We got opportunities. We got opportunities. So, now that that advertisement is over, hear now these Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who feel like they need to hide in a hole while the world is destroyed, for they deeply feel the heartbeat of the world. Blessed are the agnostics. Blessed are they who doubt. Those who aren't sure, who can still be surprised. Blessed are they who are spiritually impoverished and therefore not so certain about everything that they no longer take in new information. Blessed are those who have nothing to offer. Blessed are they for whom nothing seems to be working. Blessed are the preschoolers who cut line in communion. Blessed are the poor in spirit. You are of heaven and Jesus blesses you. One day you will laugh so hard milk comes out your nose. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are they for whom death is not an abstraction. Blessed are they who have buried their loved ones and for whom tears are as real as an ocean. Blessed are they who have loved enough to know what loss feels like. Blessed are the mothers of the miscarried. Blessed are they who don't have the luxury of taking things for granted anymore. And blessed are they who can't fall apart because they have to keep it together for everyone else. Blessed are the motherless, the alone, the ones from whom much has been taken. Blessed are those who still aren't over it yet. Blessed are they who laughed again when for so long they thought they never would. Blessed are those who mourn. You are of heaven, and Jesus blesses you. One day you will feel the arms of God around you. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who no one else notices, the kids who sit alone at the middle school lunch tables, the laundry guys at the hospital, the sex workers and the night shift street sweepers. Blessed are the losers and the babies and the parts of ourselves that are so small. The parts of ourselves that don't want to make eye contact with a world that only loves the winners. Blessed are the forgotten. Blessed are the closeted. Blessed are the unemployed, the unimpressive, the underrepresented. Blessed are those who have to figure out ways to hide new cuts on their arms. Blessed are those so desperate that they felt a need to hang on to any politician's promise. Blessed are the meek. You are of heaven, and Jesus blesses you. You will find your strength in your compassion for others. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the wrongly accused, the ones who never catch a break, the ones for whom life is hard, for they are the ones whom Jesus chose to surround himself. Blessed are those without documentation, those fleeing from one war into another. Blessed are the ones without lobbyists. Blessed are the foster kids and trophy kids and special ed kids and every other kid who just wants to feel safe and loved and never does. Blessed are the protesters in the cold, wearing hats that symbolize words they never would have said aloud before. Blessed are those who brave water hoses from the National Guard in order to protect the water of their people and all of us. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are you who know that there has to be more than this, because you are right. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are those who make terrible business decisions for the sake of people. Blessed are the burnout social workers and the overworked teachers and the pro bono case takers. Blessed are the lawyers who show up in an instant to keep the refugee from being sent back to a war zone. Blessed are the kids who step between the bullies and the weak. Blessed are they who delete hateful comments from their friend's Facebook page. Blessed are the ones who have received such real grace that they are no longer in the position of ever deciding who the deserving poor are. Blessed is everyone who has ever forgiven me when I didn't deserve it. Blessed are the merciful, for they totally get it. They already know what mercy is. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the saints of children's time who know that the answer is almost always love, though sometimes it is squirrel. Blessed are they who ask how good a good God could let terrible things happen. Blessed are the ones who took the Bible at its word, even when their religious leaders ignored it. Blessed are the poets, the artists, the visionaries, who can see a better world than we can see ourselves. Blessed are you who feel wounded by the callousness of the world. You hold God's vision of the world up for us. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who manage to talk to the relatives at Thanksgiving that voted differently from them. Blessed are they who bring pies to their neighbors who had signs up for a different political candidate, or who mediate between divided family members, who see the common ground beneath the arguments. Blessed are the Christians who value peace so much that they will sign up for a Muslim registry. Blessed are Muslims who will guard the worship houses of Christian communities in nations where Christians are under siege. Blessed are those who show up to paint over graffiti, to draw hearts over curse words, and to remind us that love wins. You are the children who are our elders. You are the teachers who know what heaven is like. Blessed are those who have been persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Blessed are those who risk hateful messages for writing their congresspeople, their newspapers, their church newsletter articles. Blessed are the journalists who went to jail this week for covering protests. Blessed are the refugees detained at airports right now. Blessed are the straight kids who let the word fag roll off their backs when they befriend the gay kids. Blessed are those who cross racial boundaries and are teased by both sides. Blessed are they who use their skills as lawyers, legislators, business owners, artists, teachers, and more to resist oppression. Blessed are those who've had spitballs thrown at them, or signs destroyed in their yard, or houses of worship threatened or burned. Blessed are those who are persecuted, for they have the Bible and God to turn to for strength. They will see a just world, a just kingdom. Friends, rejoice. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Blessed are you, my friends. Blessed are you, for we are part of a long lineage of resistors. This is the inauguration of this term of resistance. But there have been many before, and there will be many after. Blessed are we for the invitation to draw close to God, close to our neighbors, and close to each other in the pursuit of justice, kindness, and humility. Blessed are you who bless others, even beyond your own belief, for you will receive joy in the kingdom of God. Blessed be. Amen.
Amen.
Rejoice, O people of God, rejoice, and let us return to God some of the gifts we have been given, that we might speak a word of hope in troublous days. Let us gather in all the gifts that God has given us. Let us pray not just with our pocketbooks, but with our actions. Let us pray with our whole body, mind, and soul, that God's will might be done. Please be seated. Let us fall silent together now in the presence of God, knowing that we're always and everywhere in that presence, but allowing ourselves to become permeable to God's will and God's way in this world. Let us pray together. Let us be at peace, but let us pledge to make peace in these moments together.
As we pray, we lift our prayers for those who have come today as strangers and guests to this congregation. We pray that God's people may sustain them, that God's words may inspire us together, and that the love of Jesus be shown to all. Remembering our world and all local churches as part of our ecumenical prayer cycle, we lift in our prayers the peoples of Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Bahrain, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, Oman, Yemen, Iran, and Iraq, and the friends and members of the Dixie Park Cornerstone Baptist Church, who are our sisters and brothers, that the hand of God will always cradle and guide us all, and that the works of God will be our yeast and our pearl. Lord, we carry in our hearts the joy and concern of so many in our midst, some we have named, others whom only you know. Hold and heal us all, named and known to you in body, mind, and spirit. We gather one and all that we may be made one in communion with you. God, your requirements for us are simple but not easy. Guide us in justice, kindness and mercy, and humility. Inspire us to speak love as our first language, always and everywhere. Clean our hearts and make them blessed, that we might become blessings to our hurting world. Let us never forget that you are our guide, our strength, our stronghold in stormy weather. God in community, three in one, we pray these things in the way Jesus taught us, reaching to you as our Maker, our Mother, and our Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please join us in our closing hymn, which is number 180 in the Black Hymnal, Blessed Are the Poor in Spirit.
is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make the journey with us. So be swift to love, make haste to be kind, and the blessing of God who made us, who loves us, and who travels with us be now with you, and now and forever. Go in peace. Amen.
Amen.